Alright, kids, let's have some fun this morning. The greatest day in history. Death is beaten, you have set me free. Sing it out, Jesus is alive. The empty cross, the empty grave. Life eternal, you have won the day. Shout it out, Jesus is alive. He's alive. Oh, happy day, happy day. You washed my sin away. Oh, happy day, happy day. I'll never be the same. Forever I am changed. When I stand in that place, free at last, meeting face to face, I am yours, Jesus, you are mine. Endless joy, perfect peace. Earthly pain finally will cease. Celebrate, Jesus is alive. He's alive. Oh, happy day, happy day. You washed my sin away. Oh, happy day, happy day. I'll never be the same. Forever I am changed. Oh, what a glorious day. What a glorious way that you have saved me. Oh, what a glorious day, what a glorious name. Yeah! Oh, happy day, happy day. You washed my sin away. Oh, happy day, happy day. I'll never be the same. Forever I am changed. I'll never be the same. Psalms 98 says, "Sing a new song to the Lord, for he has performed wonders. His right hand and holy arm have won him victory. The Lord has made his victory known. He has revealed his righteousness in the sight of the nations. He has remembered his love and faithfulness to the house of Israel. All the ends of the earth have seen our God's victory. Let the whole earth shout to the Lord. Be jubilant, shout for joy and sing. Sing to the Lord with the lyre and melodious song, with trumpets and the blast of the ram's horn. Shout triumphantly in the presence of the Lord our King. Let the sea and all that fills it, the world and those who live in it, resound. Let the rivers clap their hands. Let the mountains shout together for joy before the Lord. For he is coming to judge the earth. He will judge the world righteously and the peoples fairly." Let's shout to the Lord this morning as we continue to worship him.
Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there is none like you. All of my days I want to praise the wonders of your mighty love. My comfort, my shelter, tower of refuge and strength. Let every breath, all that I am, never cease to worship you. Shout to the Lord, all the earth, let us sing. Power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name. I sing for joy at the work of your hands. Forever I'll love you, forever I'll stand. Nothing compares to the promise I have in you. My Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there is none like you. All of my days I want to praise the wonders of your mighty love. My comfort, my shelter, tower of refuge and strength. Let every breath, all that I am, never cease to worship you. Shout to the Lord, all the earth, let us sing. Power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name. I sing for joy at the work of your hands. Forever I'll love you, forever I'll stand. Nothing compares to the promise I have. Shout to the Lord, all the earth, let us sing. Power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name. I sing for joy at the work of your hands. Forever I'll love you, forever I'll stand. Nothing compares to the promise I have. Nothing compares to the promise I have. Nothing compares to the promise I have in you.
Well, good morning. I want to thank you for being with us again. We are meeting later today with the church board as we plan with our district and general leadership as to how to reopen during this crisis, and we will be forwarding all that information on to you very shortly. Let's have a word of prayer as we start today. Lord Jesus, thank you again for the privilege of being in your house, to be able to share together the message that you have brought today, Lord, and may it just inspire us and encourage us in such a way that our lives always draw closer to you. You're an amazing God who has done so much for us, and may our faith just continue to find its foundation in you, Lord Jesus, because we believe more than anything else that you are the creator, the healer. Lord, you're the one that is going to bring us through this, and we just thank you so much. And I pray now that you'll be with each one that watches this message, that you will just bless them and their household, that they will be encouraged to know that the living God is with them. We ask all this in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Well, as I start the message today, we're going to do things a little different. I want to play a little game. So Hang in there with me. What I'm going to do is I'm going to play a couple sounds, and I want you to try to identify what these sounds are. Did you figure it out? Well, if you're a mechanic, you probably have an advantage over some of the other people. These sounds were actually a car engine that has thrown a rod, and is also, the other sound was a CV joint that has gone bad in a car. Now, why did I play these? Because I want you to realize something today. Both of these sounds were a result of either poor maintenance or a lot of wear and tear. And so, as we keep that in mind, let's move on to the spiritual application here. Because with our faith, poor maintenance and wear and tear can cause us to fail if we don't have the proper focus. And so, what I want us to look at today is Paul's message to Timothy that is found over in 1 Timothy chapter 1, verses 12 through 19. 1 Timothy chapter 1, verses 12 through 19. And so let's take a look at this as we go through it. It starts out in the passage of Scripture. Paul says, I thank Christ Jesus our Lord, who has given me strength, that he has considered me faithful, appointing me to his service. So, what we see here is what Jesus does as we're starting out this passage of Scripture. For Paul, he says, he gives me strength, he makes me faithful, or qualifies him, he appoints him for service, or sends him out. Now, these all apply to us as well in our spiritual lives. For it is without any hesitation that I say that God gives us strength, that God makes us faithful, or that he qualifies us to do his work, that he appoints us for his service, and he sends us out with a message. Now, this thought came to me, and please don't take this wrong, because I'm going to try to explain to you how I was encouraged with this thought, and I was thinking about back before we had heard of the coronavirus, and I got thinking, and I know, I'm sorry, I get tired of hearing about it too, but I was thinking about how all of a sudden they said that it appeared in some kind of a laboratory or something. I don't know if they've ever completely figured that out, but this coronavirus started in just one person. And then it has spread throughout the world. And as I was thinking the other day, I thought, isn't that the way that we are supposed to convey the love of Jesus Christ? That it starts out in our hearts, but it doesn't just stay here. It just spreads out, and it spreads through communities, and it spreads through countries, and all around the world. The message of the love of Jesus Christ is to spread. So, I'm sorry, that thought just came to me, and I was so taken in by that. If we could just have the love of Christ with that kind of an effect on others and on our world, and just a complete opposite of what we're dealing with this virus, instead of all the bad things that are a result of it, it would certainly bring good news, and it would bring healing, and it would bring unity. And so, please be encouraged by that, and let's do all that we can, seriously, to share the love of Christ and how life-changing that is. Well, back to the scripture, verse 13. Even though I once was a blasphemer and a persecutor and a violent man, I was shown mercy because I acted in ignorance and unbelief. The grace of our Lord was poured out on me abundantly, along with the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus. So this is basically Paul's before and after statement. He says, this is who I was before Jesus. And he begins to list all of these terrible things that were part of his life and what really made up who Paul was at that point and actually is Saul. But that's who he was at that point. And he describes these things and how wretched he was and how terrible these things are. But then he says that Christ changed all of this. And so this is his before and after statement. And I want to encourage you today because this could very well be our before and after statement. That God has done so much for us. We were all sinners. We were all living apart from what God wanted for us. The reason that we were created, the reason that we were put here on this earth, we were all living separate from that. But today we have a before and after statement. I hope you do. Because it's what our lives were like before Christ, and it's what our lives are like now, that Jesus Christ, if we simply say, Lord, forgive me of my sins and become my God, he will do that, and he will become our Lord. Our lives will change, and you and I will have a before and after statement, just like Paul did. Well, let's look at his motivation, because I believe it's the same motivation we have. In verse 15, he says, here is a trustworthy saying that deserves full acceptance. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the worst. So the motivation here is basically, we could just say, is salvation. That Jesus Christ, when he saw us in that before and after that I was talking about, when he saw us in that before state, he knew that we were wretched and hopeless. He knew that we were living a life that was outside of his plan for us. And so he brought to us, through Jesus Christ, the ability of salvation. The opportunity, maybe I should say, of salvation. That you and I could be born again by confessing our sins and inviting Jesus Christ in. So Paul's motivation then is simply that. It is salvation. And that needs to be our motivation. Understanding that you and I can be changed in Jesus Christ. Why? It's not just for us. It's not a selfish salvation. I don't believe there is such a thing. But it's a salvation that says not only has God changed my life. Look at how Paul describes himself as the worst of all sinners. Not only has Christ changed my life, but he can change your life. That's the message here. And I believe this is Paul's motivation as he's writing to Timothy and telling him, these are the things that you need to consider. Moving on, verse 16, he says, but for that very reason I was shown mercy, so that in me, the worst of all sinners, Christ Jesus might display his unlimited patience as an example for those who would believe on him and receive eternal life. Wow. So it's salvation for everyone. That's what he's telling us. He's saying that Christ will display this unlimited patience as an example to those who would believe on him and receive eternal life. There are paths that we choose in life, and some of them bring us happiness, some of them bring us regret. Some of them bring us a life of constant regret. But whatever those paths are, we need to understand today. Maybe I should say it like this. No matter what you've done, no matter how terrible you think it has been, no matter how much you feel like you failed Jesus, no matter how much you feel like you have failed others, he gives us an opportunity to change. And that opportunity is for everyone. It is called salvation. It's through repentance in Jesus Christ. He is the only one worthy, the only one able. He is the only one capable, the only one who can forgive us of our sins. So Paul goes on and encouraging to Timothy, and he says this in verse 17. Now to the King, eternal, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. So it is really an understanding of who Jesus is. He calls him the eternal King. He is never going to fail. He is never going to fade. He is never going to leave us and abandon us. He is the eternal King that is here forever and ever, and you and I must trust in Him. We must find our strength and our hope and in all these things, happiness, all these things in life, in this journey that comes from putting our little hand into God's big hand and trusting in Him. And that's the message that He's saying. He's the eternal King. He's not going anywhere. He is the eternal King. He's immortal. Nobody's ever going to do away with God, for God is God. And no one's going to change any of that. He is forever. He is in heaven, and someday, you and I and all those who have been faithful to Him are going to be joined together in the kingdom in heaven that God has prepared for us to live in. And that's exciting news. The other thing He said, He's invisible. And I was reading John's Gospel, chapter 1 and verse 18. No one has ever seen God, but God, the one and only, who is at the Father's side, has made Him known. So this invisible God is real. He's here. People may say, well, if He is, show me a picture of Him. You see, that's what this invisible means. We don't have a picture of Him, at least not a physical picture. But what we do have is this idea that He has made Himself known to us. There are so many different areas that God has made us know, that He's made Himself known to us. And that is in things like creation. I mean, look around. Look at the outdoors. It has God all over it. Look at the lives of a newborn. How can that happen? That's just a part of God's plan for us. And as we look at how things have changed over the years, we see that God's plan for us is for us to become a new creation. That the old me would disappear, would go, would be gone. It's actually crucified through Christ. And that the new me would serve Him faithfully because of the love that He has put into my heart and my life. So He says He is the only God. And I remember, as I was writing this, I remember the verse, and you probably know it too, Acts 4:12. Salvation is found in nowhere and no one else. For there is no other name under heaven given to men by which we must be saved. So He's telling us that this is the only God that can do this. The only one who can. The only one who has ever. The only one who has the ability to forgive our sins and to turn our lives around. He indeed is the only God. Well, there's a battle that's going on in life. There's a battle that's going on here. Paul describes this to Timothy in verse 18. He says, Timothy, my son, I give you this instruction in keeping with the prophecies once made about you, so that by following them, you may fight the good fight. You see, he's talking about God's revelation to us. And he's saying that in these, with understanding now, that they have taken root in our lives, if you will. In these, we will fight the good fight because it is God's love, it is God's provisions that now have taken over our lives. And so there's a battle because the enemy still wants you back, and he's going to continue to fight. But what he's telling Timothy, I want to encourage you because I've seen the presence of God living in your life. And as long as the presence of God is living in your life is going to move in a positive direction. So there is a battle. Fight the good fight. Hold on to Jesus Christ. Now let me, as we get close to finishing up here, let me share a couple things out of verse 19 real quick. Holding on to faith and a good conscience. Some have rejected these and have so shipwrecked their faith. So the first thing it says is hold on to the essentials. Hold on to the things that faith brings into your life. Faith itself is a godly provision. A good conscience is a result of that. As we live for Him today, those are the things that we're supposed to do, and we recognize that. Then it says the second part of verse 19 says this, that some have shipwrecked their faith. You know what a shipwreck is? That some have shipwrecked their faith because they have turned away from the things of God, the faith and the good conscience, and they started following things of the world that Satan is offering to them as temptations, and they begin contemplating them. And anytime you begin to contemplate temptations with Satan, you're going to lose. So you've got to understand, when that temptation comes around, that there should be something going on up here that says, I know that's not God's will for my life, and because of that, I choose not to follow it. I'm going to follow the way of God. Well, he goes on, and finally, and he says this, in the last verse, verse 20, among them are Hymenaeus and Alexander, whom I have handed over to Satan to be taught not to blaspheme. He handed him over to Satan. Now, back when we started this message, I let you listen to a couple sounds, and they were sounds that were not good sounds. Sounds of automobile problems, and we've all had those, right? Well, now if we look at verse 20, I want you to get this, because what he's really saying is that he's sending these two to the junkyard, if you will. Much worse than that, but at least it gives us some type of a picture as to what's going on here. Because I believe that this has redemption wrote all over it. Let me explain that to you. I believe that as he sent them away, it doesn't say for eternity. It just says to be taught that they shouldn't blaspheme. And so, is that the end of their lives? Well, here's something I don't know. But here's something I want you to consider right here. When a car goes to the junkyard, all kinds of bad things happen. When a car sits around for a while, it begins to take on rust. I've noticed as we haven't been driving our cars, if you look through the openings of the wheel and you look at the brake rotors, you see rust starting to gather on those brake rotors. And that's not a good thing. But when a car goes to the junkyard, it sits there, and everything in it begins to seize up. Everything in it begins to rust. The tires, if it still had tires on it, the air leaks out of them, they begin to dry rot, and all of these bad things begin to happen to a car that has been sent to the junkyard. Now, so why did I say this has redemption wrote all over it? Because of this. I was thinking about this. Bad things happen while in the junkyard, but it also gives us the opportunity of restoration. You see, the car that is sitting in the junkyard that all of these things have happened to, some people look at that and say, what a shame, what a waste. Or some people look at it and say, I'm glad to get that mess out of my hands. But every now and then you find a unique individual who will look at that in the condition that it's in and say, wow, what an opportunity for restoration. You see, I believe that's how Jesus is looking at our lives. I believe that's what Paul is trying to communicate to Timothy here. He's seen this firsthand. He knows the change that's taken place in his life. And now he's saying that there is an opportunity for restoration in our lives. In other words, if you know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, then be obedient to Him. Have faith in Him. Follow Him. These are the things that we're supposed to be doing. Be an encouragement to others through the faith that you have in Jesus Christ. But if you feel like you've been sitting in an old junkyard somewhere and that you don't amount to anything, or maybe you feel like your life is too far gone to ever accomplish anything positive, I want to tell you today, it is not true. Because Jesus Christ has a plan for your life. Jesus Christ is the one who will walk through the junkyard of life, and He will look at people's bodies, and He will look at all of the missed opportunities, and He will look at all of the sinful and bad decisions that we've made in our lives. And He will look at us and say, but I believe that person has the opportunity of restoration. And that's how much He loves us. And that's the story that He's communicating here. Jesus Christ wants to restore your life to be the person that He intended you to be. I hope you understand that today. Will you pray with me as we close? Lord Jesus, if there's anyone listening that does not know the peace of God in their life, I would pray right now that they would just say a little prayer that would say something like, Lord, I may not understand it all, but I know that my life is not where it needs to be. Please forgive my sins. Come into my life and become my God, that I may be faithful to you the rest of the days of my life. For we serve a God of restoration, a God of opportunity, and I believe without any doubt, Lord, that you can change my life for the positive. And so therefore, Lord Jesus, I commit my life to you right now. And I pray in the name of Jesus Christ that my life of restoration will take place and that I can be who you created me to be and that I can live on this earth as the person that you wanted me to live as. Lord Jesus, may your strength, may your peace, and may your presence forever just somehow envelop our lives that we can be the person that you've intended us to be. There are all kinds of challenges out here, but there's an amazing God who loves us so much and wants us to succeed in life. Please, Lord, give us that strength as the opportunity is here. May it happen in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, thank you so much for sharing with us this day. May God richly bless your life as you continue to trust in Him. And can I say this? If you've prayed that prayer and you need some encouragement, would you please just, it's very easy to contact me. I have a very simple email address, pastordupler@yahoo.com. D-U-P-L-E-R, pastordupler@yahoo.com. And let me know that God is working with you. Let me know if there's anything else I can do to encourage you. I just want you to be faithful to Him. And I want us to work together to change our community and our world for Jesus Christ. Thank you, and God bless you.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound. Amazing love, now flowing down from hands and feet that were nailed to a tree. As grace flows down and covers me. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound. Amazing love, now flowing down from hands and feet that were nailed to a tree. As grace flows down and covers me, it covers me. Covers me. It covers me. And covers me. Amazing how sweet the sound. Amazing love, now flowing down from hands and feet that were nailed to a tree. As grace flows down and covers me, it covers me.